So as we now know, the matrix of the mitochondria is where we break down our fatty acids. We can oxidize the fatty acids into acetyl coenzyme molecules, and then we can use those molecules to basically generate ATP molecules via the citric acid cycle. Now, although the majority of the fatty acids are oxidized, are broken down in the matrix of the mitochondria, there is another location of oxidation of fatty acids that occurs inside our cells, and this is inside peroxisomes. So remember that peroxisomes are membrane-bound organelles that also contain enzymes involved in the fatty acid oxidation process. Now, what types of fatty acids do we generally oxidize and break down in our peroxisomes? Well, it's the fatty acids that contain 20 or more carbon atoms. So these are known as very long-chain fatty acids, or simply VLCFA. Now, what exactly is the major difference between the beta oxidation process that takes place inside our mitochondria and inside peroxisomes? Well, the major difference is step one of beta oxidation. So remember that in step one of beta oxidation inside the matrix of the mitochondria, we have an enzyme that catalyzes a reaction in which we basically oxidize the fatty acid, and that helps us generate an FADH2 molecule. Now, what about inside the peroxisomes? Well, inside the peroxisome, it's this step that takes place. So let's suppose we have some type of very long chain fatty acid. Let's suppose our end value here is 16 or greater, so that this entire molecule contains at least 20 carbon atoms. Now, in step one, we basically transform this single bond between carbon number 2 and 3 into a double bond. And at the same time, we basically reduce the FAD molecule into an FADH2 molecule. Now, this group, the FAD, is actually found bound to the acyl coenzyme A dehydrogenase. So this is a flavin protein dehydrogenase, and it's different than the enzyme that catalyzes step one of the beta oxidation process that we typically see in the matrix of the mitochondria. Now, this process doesn't stop here. Remember that in the matrix of the mitochondria, we generate that FADH2 molecule that then can be used by the electron transport chain. But in the peroxisome, those electrons are then transferred onto an oxygen molecule, and that oxygen molecule is used to form an H2O2 molecule, hydrogen peroxide. And this is a very toxic molecule. And that's exactly why inside the peroxisome, we find another enzyme known as catalase. And it's the catalase that helps detoxify this hydrogen peroxide into oxygen and water. So once this process takes place and we form the H2O2 molecule, it's the catalase that acts on 2 moles of these molecules to form 2 moles of water and 1 mole of oxygen. Now, once we generate this intermediate molecule, it then follows the same exact identical steps that we typically find in the matrix of the mitochondria. And this process of the normal beta oxidation continues until we form a fatty acid that contains 8 carbon atoms. And once we form that, that is then transported into the matrix of the mitochondrion, where that oxidation process is completed to form the acetyl coenzyme A molecules that can be used to generate the high energy ATP molecule. So this is what we basically find in the peroxisomes. Now, what is the importance of peroxisomes? If we have those mitochondria to basically help us undergo the fatty acid oxidation process, why do we need peroxisomes in the first place? Well, to answer that condition, we can basically study a set of genetic disorders that are known as the Zellweger spectrum syndromes. Now, the Zellweger syndrome is the very severe form of the Zellweger spectrum syndrome, while the adrenal leukodystrophy is a slightly less severe form. Now, in both of these cases, there is some type of genetic mutation in proteins known as pyroxenes. And these proteins, called pyroxenes, are basically responsible for actually forming the peroxisome. So in patients, in individuals with these genetic conditions, the peroxisomes don't actually form correctly or don't form at all. And so what that means is these very long chain fatty acids will not be broken down and they will increase in concentration in those individuals. In addition, peroxisomes have other functions. For instance, peroxisomes also synthesize those lipid molecules that are found in the myelin sheath around neurons, around the axons of neurons. And so if peroxisomes do not actually form correctly, what that means is we cannot form the myelin sheath. And so individuals with these conditions will basically have problems with their muscle tissue, with their liver, with their kidneys, as well as with the nervous system and other tissues. So to summarize, we see that our fatty acid oxidation doesn't only take place in the matrix of the mitochondria, it also takes place in the peroxisome. And what the peroxisome ultimately does is it helps us take the very long chain fatty acids, it helps us actually shorten those fatty acids so that they can be then transported into the matrix of the mitochondria and broken down by the beta oxidation step that takes place inside the matrix of the mitochondrion.